Hello everyone, Gyaus on this side. So today hand we are starting with a new topic called as exchange of gases, or what we call as respiration. Today hand we'll be dealing with the introductory portion of the chapter, that's called as external respiration and the internal respiration. So let's get started. Now basically if you are dealing with any of the gas molecule, These gas molecules establish an equilibrium between the molecules which are dissolved in liquid and those which are dissolved in the air. Now, basically, the composition of the air in the atmosphere and in the alveoli differs. Now, what does this alveoli means? So, basically, alveoli are nothing but the basic functional units of lungs. Okay? Or rather, I should call that alveoli is the functional unit of respiration. So basically, both in the air as well and in the alveoli as well, the concentration of the gases is, it is the nitrogen which is present in the highest amount, then the oxygen is on the second amount, the third one is called the water molecules or water vapor, and the last but not the least one is the carbon dioxide. So the amount of the nitrogen is greater than the oxygen is greater than the water vapor is greater than the carbon dioxide. So the least amount of the gas which is present in the alveoli as well and in the air as well is none other than carbon dioxide. Now, the amount of water vapor which is present in the alveolar air is greater than the atmospheric air. The amount of water vapor which is present in the alveoli is greater than the atmospheric air. We'll be dealing with this in the table. Now, ultimately the respiratory system works to humidify, which means like the addition of the water, works to humidify the incoming air. So ultimately, it will be causing the air which is present in the alveoli to have a great amount of water, to have a great amount of water vapor than the atmospheric air. And in addition as well, the alveolar air contains a great amount of carbon dioxide as well and less amount of oxygen than the atmospheric air. Please do remember one thing, that the alveoli air contains a great amount of the carbon dioxide and a less amount of the oxygen as compared to the atmospheric air. Now, here if I'll be dealing with, there's no surprise at all that the gas exchange removes the oxygen from and adds the carbon dioxide to the alveolar air. Basically, the alveoli will be giving the oxygen and it will be taking the carbon dioxide. So ultimately both the deep and the forced breathing caused the alveolar air composition to be changed more rapidly than quiet breathing. I repeat, if you are undergoing the deep breathing or the forced breathing, it causes the alveolar air composition to be changed more rapidly as compared to the quiet breathing. And ultimately, as a result of this, the partial pressure of oxygen and the carbon dioxide changes, which affect the diffusion process, like the movement of the molecule from the higher concentration to the lower concentration respectively. It process the like the affecting the diffusion process that moves the material across the membrane, and this will be causing the oxygen to enter in the blood. Okay, deal with. Now here we are dealing with the proper table, the percentage of the gas in the total composition of the environment and the partial pressure which is present in the alveoli. So ultimately, if I'll be going for the case, please do remember one thing, that what is the meaning of the partial pressure? So the meaning of the partial pressure is, it is the pressure exerted by one single gas in the mixture of different gases. So starting with the first thing first, the first gas is called as the nitrogen. The percentage of the total composition of the atmosphere is 74.9 of the nitrogen. But the partial pressure which is measured in the mm of mercury, it is 569. And if I am dealing with the oxygen, so ultimately oxygen is giving you almost 13.7% of total composition of the atmosphere, whereas here you are having 104 mmHg. Now, If I am dealing with the water, that is like the water vapor we have studied, it's like 6.2 in the atmosphere and 40 mmHg in the alveoli. And if I am dealing with the carbon dioxide, the last but not the least gas of the respiration, the total composition is a 5.2 in the atmosphere versus 47 mmHg in the alveoli. So if you are taking the total percent, here you will be having 100 and here you are dealing like the mmHg 760 combinedly. Okay, now dealing with one of the most important term here in the respiration called as a ventilation. So here, the first term is ventilation and the second term is perfusion. So the first thing first. There are two important aspects of the gas exchange in the lung. They are ventilation and perfusion. The first one is a ventilation. The ventilation is the movement of air. Ventilation is the movement of air into and out of the lungs. Basically, whenever like the air is coming in the lungs or the air is leaving the lung, that will be called as a ventilation. And the perfusion is the flow of blood in the pulmonary capillaries. Okay, deal with. Now, for the gas exchange to be efficient, the volumes involved in the ventilation and perfusion should be compatible. The volumes which are involved in the ventilation and the perfusion should be compatible. However, the factors such as like the regional gravity effects on the blood, so ultimately it blocked alveolar ducts, like the if the ducts are blocked, or some diseases also causes ventilation and perfusion to be imbalanced. So for like the in an ideal condition, a normal healthy human being should have the ventilation and the perfusion in a compatible manner. Okay, now gas exchange. Here the gas exchange occurs at two sites in the body. The first one is called as the lungs. In the lungs, the gas exchange occurs in the lungs, where oxygen is picked up and carbon dioxide is released. At the respiratory membrane and at the tissues. So ultimately, like on the tissue or on the cellular level, you are taking, your cells and the tissues are taking the oxygen and they are giving back the carbon dioxide. Where the oxygen, like ultimately, external respiration is, then starting with the first thing first, like the important topic, first one is called as external respiration. It is the exchange of gases with the external environment. And it occurs in the alveoli of the lungs. And the second one is called as the internal respiration. So it is the exchange of the gases within the internal environment and it occurs in the tissues. So the exchange of the gases from the atmosphere to the lungs is called as external respiration, whereas the exchange of the gases from the blood to the tissues is called as an internal respiration. The actual exchange of the gases occur due to simple diffusion. I've already told you, but again I'm giving you the definition of the diffusion. It is nothing but just like the flow of the molecules from higher concentration to the lower concentration. And basically, if the process is simple diffusion, there is no energy required to move the oxygen or the carbon dioxide across the membranes, because it's a passive process. Okay, now instead, these gases follow the pressure gradient that allows them to diffuse. They'll be following the law of the pressure, and the law of pressure says that everything which is like the flowing from the higher concentration to the lower concentration, that is like ultimately towards the pressure gradient or towards the concentration gradient, anything flows from its higher concentration to the lower concentration. Please do remember these physical concepts as well. Now, the anatomy of the lung maximizes the diffusion of the gases. And the respiratory membrane is highly permeable to the gases. And the respiratory and the blood capillary membranes are very thin. There is a large surface area through the lungs. So basically, like the case, The respiratory membrane is highly permeable to the gases as well, be it oxygen, be it carbon dioxide, whatever it may be. But these two only. And like some amount of the carbon monoxide as well. The respiratory and the blood capillaries are very thin, and that is the reason they are providing a large surface area for the binding purpose of these special gases. Now, here, dealing with the first thing first called as external respiration. The pulmonary artery carries deoxygenated blood into the lungs from the heart. We do know about the pulmonary artery and the pulmonary vein as well. And I'm assuming that you should, like you already know the basic concept about the pulmonary artery and the pulmonary vein. Here, it carries deoxygenated blood into the lungs from the heart. That is like correct one. Where the branches and eventually, like where it branches, and eventually it becomes the capillary network, which is composed of pulmonary capillaries, which does contain the deoxygenated blood for now. These pulmonary capillaries create the respiratory membrane within the alveoli. And we do know, like if the surface area has been increased, like it will be very simple for the gases to diffuse now. As the blood is pumped through this capillary network, the gas exchange will occur, because the gaseous exchange is following just a simple phenomena called as a simple diffusion, and there's a whole lot of like the surface area which is present. So ultimately majority of the gases will be absorbed here, oxygen and the carbon dioxide will be eliminated. Although a small amount of the oxygen is able to dissolve directly in the plasma from the alveoli, majority of the oxygen is picked up by the erythrocytes. And what is the name of that special protein? That protein which picks up the oxygen, and the protein which is called as the oxygen transporter, is called as none other than a quaternary protein called as hemoglobin. A quaternary protein which is called as hemoglobin, which is having like the four different subunits in its structure. Alpha, alpha dash, beta and the beta dash. I'll be dealing with those topics as well. Now here, a process that is described, like ultimately I'll be describing the next topics, that is the oxygenated hemoglobin is red. I repeat, oxygenated hemoglobin is red, which causes the overall appearance of the bright red oxygenated blood. So if you are about to observe the color of the blood, and ultimately if you are observing like the color of the blood is bright red, give the conclusion that the blood is oxygenated, which returns to the heart through the pulmonary veins. Like the oxygenated blood is carried through the pulmonary veins. And the carbon dioxide is released in the opposite direction of the oxygen. Carbon dioxide is released in the opposite direction of the oxygen from the blood to the alveoli. So ultimately, like if the oxygen is coming from this area, the CO2 will be coming from this area. Okay, deal with. Now, some of the carbon dioxide is returned to the hemoglobin as well, but can also be dissolved in the plasma or is present as a converted one. So basically, like, I won't be going for that topic right now. Like I'm just giving you a glimpse that some of the carbon dioxide is returned on the hemoglobin, but can always like also be dissolved in the plasma as well in the form of carbonic acid, HCO3-. Now, although the solubility of the oxygen in the blood is not high, there is a drastic difference in the partial pressure of oxygen in the alveoli versus in the blood of pulmonary capillaries. How come? Let's check it out. Now, the difference is about 64 mmHg. It's a huge, because the partial pressure of the oxygen in the alveoli is 104 mmHg, whereas the partial pressure in the blood of the capillary is about 40 mmHg only. So if you are dealing, and if you are like going for a normal mathematical calculation, just subtract 40 from 104. The result you will be getting will be 64. So ultimately, this large difference in the partial pressure is creating a very strong pressure gradient. This large difference in the partial pressure is creating a very strong pressure gradient that is causing the oxygen to rapidly cross the respiratory membrane from the alveoli. That is causing the oxygen to rapidly cross the respiratory membrane from the alveoli into the blood. So ultimately, like anything or everything always flows from higher concentration to the lower concentration. From higher concentration to the lower concentration. So ultimately, if the oxygen's concentration or the pressure in the alveoli is almost 104 mmHg and in the blood is only 40, so automatically like the oxygen will be transferring from 104 to the 40. And like the transfer will be very fast, and we have a word in the English language for the very fast is rapid. Okay, deal with. Now, the partial pressure of carbon dioxide is also different between the alveolar air and the blood of the capillary. The partial pressure of carbon dioxide is also different between the alveolar air and the blood of the capillary. However, the partial pressure is different. The partial pressure difference is less than oxygen. Is less than that of oxygen. It is only 5 mmHg. The difference between like this is the only 5 mmHg. Here, the partial pressure of carbon dioxide in the blood is 45 mmHg. Whereas the partial pressure in the alveoli is about 40 mmHg. So ultimately, these both are ultimately like the vice versa cases, something like this. The oxygen will be diffused from the alveoli to the blood, whereas the carbon dioxide has to be diffused from the blood to the alveoli, because they both have to follow the law of concentration. They have to go, or they have to flow from their higher concentration to their lower concentration. Okay, deal with. But ultimately, you can observe that the partial pressure difference is very much less in carbon dioxide as compared to the oxygen. Now, however, the solubility of carbon monoxide is much greater. The solubility of the carbon monoxide is much greater than that here. By a factor of about 20, in both blood and alveolar fluid, so ultimately, like the carbon dioxide is showing you more solubility as compared to the oxygen. Now, here, dealing with the second phase of the respiration called as the internal respiration. So basically, internal respiration is gas exchange that occurs at the level of the body tissues. This is similar to external respiration. But here it also occurs like automatically does follows the simple diffusion phenomena due to the partial pressure gradient. But ultimately, the partial pressure gradient are opposite of those which are present in the respiratory membrane. Now, the partial pressure of the oxygen in the tissues is low. That is about 40 mmHg. The partial pressure of oxygen in the tissues is 40 mmHg because the oxygen is continuously used for respiration. And that is called as a cellular respiration, which means energy formation or the energy synthesis in the form of ATP. Okay, please deal with. Now, like this whole phenomena occurs in the mitochondria, the cellular respiration. Here, now, if I'll be dealing with the case, the partial pressure of oxygen in the blood is 100 mmHg. And ultimately, like the partial pressure of the oxygen in the tissue is 40 mmHg. So ultimately, you will be observing a pressure gradient that is causing the oxygen to dissociate from hemoglobin. The binding of the oxygen to the hemoglobin is temporary. So here it will be causing the oxygen to dissociate from hemoglobin and diffusing out of the blood, and it will be dealing like the crossing the interstitial space, and it will be entering in the tissue. So whatever the blood, like blood cells, specifically the erythrocytes, they have brought the oxygen. Now the oxygen will be detached from them because the oxygen has to follow the law of concentration. Hemoglobin that has a little oxygen, it bounds to its loose, like hemoglobin that has a little oxygen bound to it loses much of its brightness. So ultimately, like the fresh red color will be converting into burgundy color. There will be a purple tinge in that red color now, or what we call as a deoxygenated blood. Okay, now here, considering the cellular respiration continuously, it produces the carbon dioxide. The partial pressure of the carbon dioxide is lower in the blood than in the tissue. So ultimately, again, it will be causing the carbon dioxide to diffuse out of the tissue for sure. And it will be crossing the interstitial fluid and it will be entering in the blood. So from the tissue to the interstitial fluid to the blood. It is then carried back to the lungs, either which are bounded to the hemoglobin, dissolved in the plasma or in a converted form. I have told you the converted form. What is that? It is none other than HCO3-. We call this ion as bicarbonate. Now, one more thing, like I have to explain you that the binding side of the oxygen and the binding side of the carbon dioxide are way different from each other. One hemoglobin molecule will be binding with the one carbon dioxide molecule in the central portion, whereas there are four different oxygen molecules can be bound to one single hemoglobin and they will be showing the cooperative binding. Which means the first molecule will be helping the second molecule to bind the hemoglobin, and these two will be helping the third one, and then like these three will be helping the fourth one. So the binding of the first hemoglobin is quite more complicated as compared to binding of the fourth oxygen molecule, because like there are three molecules which are ready to help that, but the first one, they have to start from the scratch. Now again, now basically here, like the carbon dioxide is diffusing out of the tissue and entering in the blood. Now it will be carried back to the lungs, which are like in the either in the bounded form, either in the dissolved plasma, or either in the converted form. Now, by the time the blood returns to the heart, the partial pressure of the oxygen has returned to about 40 mmHg. And the partial pressure of the carbon dioxide has returned to about 45 mmHg. Now the blood is then pumped back to the lungs to be oxygenated once again during the external respiration. So ultimately, like I will, whenever I'll be dealing with the circulation portion, I'll be explaining you how the double circulation works. But for the time being, please do remember one thing. Here both the gases are forming, here both the gases are following the law of concentration, but in antagonistic form or in opposite form. The oxygen will be absorbed from the lungs, whereas the carbon dioxide will be thrown in the lungs, or like rather it will be excreted out of the body. Do remember one thing, that the lungs also like play an important role in the excretion of carbon dioxide. Done? Okay. Hopefully this introductory lecture has been beneficial for you guys. Thank you very much for your so much support. Please do subscribe our channel. And request I should make now, you have to comment on my videos, because whatever the videos which are being commented by you, ultimately they are getting much more higher ratings than those which do not have the comments. Okay, thank you very much.